Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome once again to Church Online. Of course, this is our Wednesday night devotional prayer time together that we always enjoy each and every week. And so again, we say thanks for allowing us to come into your home like we are today. Well, I want to just share an exciting announcement with you. After all of this smoke and fires and all these things that have been going on, the air quality being disastrous here in LA County, we're excited to let you know we're going to be meeting this Sunday night in the courtyard area, Lord willing. We're going to be meeting this Sunday night in the courtyard area at 6 o'clock. So if you can at all come and join us and be a part of our great time together, time of worship and praise, the word, will be serving communion as well. And then following our time together, we'll have ice cream for everyone. So we're looking forward to that. As always, we'll be taking extra measures in making sure that we disinfect the chairs. We have sanitation station, hand sanitizers in different parts of the property. So we want to invite you to come and enjoy, and we're looking forward to seeing each and every one of you. It's been several weeks now since we've been able to meet as a result of the fires, the heat, and the air quality. So, you know, that put aside, we're looking forward to connecting this Sunday night at 6 p.m. So I hope to see each and every one of you there. As you know, the political race is heating up. And if you're like me, you're thinking, listen, I hear a lot of things on the networks, but I want to know, what is the truth? What do these candidates represent? And I just want you to know, I have found that there is no other website that offers as much information as does this website. And so I want to encourage you to go to it, log on, and then there are just all kinds of informations on candidates, the platforms of the different parties, what they stand for, what they believe in, the presidential candidates themselves, what they stand for, what they believe in, and not just what they talk about, but how they have voted and how they have moved forward. And so I want to encourage you to go to this website. It's prayvotestand.org. prayvotestand.org. I want to say it one more time, and I just want to encourage you, strongly encourage you, to go online and check out this site, and there's just a plethora of information that's there. So once again, it's prayvotestand.org. And so again, I want to encourage you, let's just continue to pray as well for the Chief Justice, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who passed away. Let's remember her family in prayer, that the Lord would be with them and bring comfort to them, and that he'd reveal himself to them during this time. And then also we want to remember the vacancy that needs to be filled. Let's pray for our president, the Senate, as they move forward in appointing just the right justice. And let's pray that that God will give them wisdom to appoint a Supreme Court justice that comes closest to making their decisions based on biblical principles. That's so very important. So let's do pray about that. Well, tonight we want to come to the last prayer request that we find in the Lord's Prayer. And there are several of them that we find in the Lord's Prayer, but this is the last request before the ending of this prayer, which we'll cover next week. But in Matthew chapter 6, verse number 13, the last prayer request goes like this here, and you can find it in verse number 13 if you have your Bible with you. And it says this here, lead us not into temptation. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, I think we'd all agree with this here, that temptation is the world's oldest problem, because it began with Adam and Eve. And but God wants to help us to overcome the temptations that come our way. And everybody's tempted. Don't let anybody tell you, Oh, I'm not tempted. I've been a Christian for 20 years, therefore I'm not tempted. No, that's just not true. Everybody is tempted. Doesn't mean that we sin or give in to temptation, but we are all tempted. Even Jesus was tempted. Some folks have weaknesses where they're tempted. It might be eating, it might be spending, it might be drinking, it might be gossiping. So there are lots of different areas in our lives where we can succumb to temptation. But we got to always remember this year that just because you're tempted doesn't mean that you have sinned. If you give in to the temptation, that's a different story. But Jesus, again, was tempted himself. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 13, it says this here in the Good News translation. It says, every temptation that comes your way is the kind that normally, and that's a good word to circle, that normally comes to people. But God keeps his promise, and he will not allow you to be tempted beyond your power to resist. At the time you are tempted, he will give you, the Lord will give you the strength to endure and to provide you with a way out. Sometimes you may have heard this, I've heard it before, where a person will say, well, man, you know what, I just didn't have a choice. I just, you know, boom, it happened, and I gave into it. The Lord always, always will help us overcome the temptation if we'll look to him and cry out to him. He says that in the scripture. So last week we talked about several ways to overcome temptation, to move past temptation. One of them we said is, listen, the way to overcome it is to refuse to be intimidated by the devil. Too often we pay so much attention to the temptation and a lot of focus on the temptation, and the temptation is real, but where does it come from? And so we just don't want to let the devil bully us at all. So refuse to be tempted. And we looked at this passage of scripture from Ephesians chapter 6, and it says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And then the writer goes on to say, put on the full armor of God. Put on the full armor of God so you can battle and fight against the wiles of temptation. No, it doesn't say that. The wiles of the devil. And so the first thing we want to do is don't allow yourself to get intimidated by the devil. Put on the full armor of God, and the Lord will help see you through. He's given us the equipment to make that happen. The second thing in overcoming temptation is not only don't let yourself be intimidated, but request help from God. Request help from God. Psalm 50, verse number 15 says this here, call to me when trouble comes. The Lord speaking to us. Call to me when trouble comes, and I will save you, and you will praise me. And isn't that the truth? Isn't that the way it happens? We find ourselves in trouble. We call upon the name of the Lord, and he's faithful. And he meets our every need. He helps us. And when he helps us through those circumstances and situations, immediately, you know, birthed in our souls is a desire to praise and to worship the Lord for his faithfulness to us. And then the third thing, and I think this is one of the most important keys in overcoming temptation, and it's this here, refocus. Refocus your attention. In James chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, it says, temptation is the pull of your own evil thoughts and wishes. These evil thoughts lend to evil actions. I once heard somebody say, the way you think determines the way you feel. The way you feel will determine the way you act. And so whatever gets your attention is going to get you. So the key in overcoming temptation is refocusing that attention off of the temptation and on to the Lord Jesus Christ, who will provide a way out, as the scripture said. The Bible also says this here in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. It says, be careful how you think. And here it goes again. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by what? The Bible says, your life Your decisions, your choices is shaped by your thoughts. So be vigilant with them. And then the fourth thing that we want to look at tonight is this helps overcome temptation as well, is reveal your struggle. Reveal that temptation that you battle with a friend. Share it with a friend. Now, I want you to be very careful with this, though. And even when I say this, I say it cautiously. Don't go out to the LA Times and share it with them and it goes all over the place. No, no, no. The Lord provides for us people within the church fellowship that we can come to, that we can share the struggle with, that will help us get through that situation and pray with us. Now, I'm not one that says, you know, share it with just, you know, every person that you see in the church, Christian or not. Don't just share with just everybody. But most people have at least one, two, sometimes three people they can share anything with. And if you have more than that, you're a very, very blessed person. But a person who can hold something in confidence and not tell anybody else, but hold it in confidence, and the only person they tell about is when they're talking to the Lord about that situation and praying for you. Now, I've been blessed. I have a couple of friends that I've had for years, since junior high. Both of them are pastors today, but we grew up together. But they're people that I can share anything with. It doesn't matter what it is, I could share it with them. I know these guys, they love me, they pray for me, they'll encourage me, they'll counsel me. And so you need to have somebody like that in your life. And if you don't have anybody like that in your life, you can always come to one of the pastoral staff. We are here to serve you and to help you and not to look at you judgmentally. We're here to pray for you and help see you through with God's help. So reveal your struggle to a person who you can share confidence with. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verses 9 and 10 says this here, two are better than one. Why? Because if one falls down, the other can help him up. But if someone is alone and falls, there's no one to help them up. In other words, the scripture's saying, when you've got somebody else, they can help you along. They can bring you along. So it's important to have that. Now, the Bible also says this here in James chapter 5, verse 16. It says, admit your sins one to another. Why? So that you might be healed. Admit your sins one to another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. So it's important for us to be able to share with folks that one or two or three people or your pastor. I'm always available to you. excuse me, but somebody that you can share your heart with. One of the fallacies and one of the things that the enemy will kind of plant in our heads is getting us to think that we're the only one that's struggling with this particular problem. Nobody else struggles with it like me. And the enemy likes to just put that in our heads. But I just want you to know, for every person who's listening in tonight, I just want you to know that that's not true. On a Sunday morning, I can stand up before the congregation and I can tell you this immediately, that there's not one person in there that has a temptation that is only something that they battle with. I look at a congregation and say, hey, no, there's probably 5 or 6 or 10 or 20. There might be 50 other people going through the same thing that you're going through. But yet the enemy wants us to think, no, no, you're the only one. And so what we do is we never deal with it. We hang on to it. We embrace it. We just cover it up and think that it's going to go away. And the scripture is clear that it's not going to go away. I've had folks who have come into my office in the last 3 churches we've pastored who will, and each church I've had folks come in and will say, you know, Pastor, I've been carrying this for years and years and years, and you're the first person that I've ever gotten the courage to share it with And this is it. And as soon as they say that, I know immediately that they're on the road to freedom. Because as long as you conceal it and try to hide it, you're not going to find victory at all. But when you can verbalize it and get somebody to hang with you, to pray with you, to encourage you, to counsel you, the Lord said, hey, I'm going to help you through it. And so make sure to share. That's one of the ways to overcoming temptation. Well, the fifth thing is resist the tempter. Don't necessarily try to resist the temptation, resist the temptation. No, resist where the temptation came from. It came from the enemy. So remember this here. It's not the temptation, but the source behind the temptation. And the Bible says in James chapter 4, verse number 7, give in to God. Give in to God tells us to do two things. Give in to God and then resist the devil. And the Bible says he'll flee from you. In other words, he'll run from you. You have that temptation that has hit you. Listen, look to God. Turn it over to God. Refocus your attention to the Lord Jesus Christ and resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. He'll run from you. Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 17 says this here, accept salvation from God, which is the helmet of salvation. He says, and receive the word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. So he's saying, listen, before you go into battle, in Ephesians chapter 5 and 6 we read, before you go into battle, put the armor on, the helmet of salvation, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. He gives us many, many, many different parts of armor to help us and to prepare us for the battle. And you'll never lose a battle because the Lord's with you. He's with you. Put on the armor of God, and you'll be able to fight against the wiles of the devil when he comes to steal and kill and destroy you. So make sure to put on that armor. You know, years ago, I think it was back like in the 70s, maybe late 70s, they had this thing that became really popular. Excuse me. Some of the younger folk probably don't even remember anything like this, but at a university in Georgia, they came up with this thing called streaking. And there were people from, University of Cal. I mean, all over, people, it just was like a craze. He said, well, what is streaking? Well, the people would take all their clothes off, and then they just run. And they did this at a university in Georgia, where they had 1,500 students that took everything they had off, and then they ran across the football field. Can you believe that there? And I've thought about that and chuckled a little bit. I thought, man alive, that's different. But, you know, I think there's a lot of followers of Jesus that leave home each and every day without their armor on. In a sense, they're out there streaking without the armor of God. And I want you to know, without the armor of God on, which he has provided for you, to do battle, victorious battle, without it, there's not a lot of hope. And that's why so many succumb to temptations that are all around them, because they don't have the armor of God on. So make sure that you have the armor of God on. And then remember, too, the passage of Scripture said, before you have the power to say no to temptation, you need to say yes to Jesus Christ. Yes to Jesus Christ. And then he mentions here, as part of the armor of God, is the sword of the Spirit. That's one of the things that you go out to battle with, the sword. What an important tool in your armory that God's provided for. That's the sword of the Spirit, which is what? You're right. It's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. Well, how do you do that? How do you wield that sword? Well, you read God's Word. Seems to always come back to this here. You read God's Word. You meditate on God's Word. You memorize God's Word. I feel like it's such an important thing for every Christian, every follower of Jesus, it's necessary, it's a must to be memorizing Scripture. You don't have to memorize a chapter a week. Even if you just did one verse, just one verse, every single week at the end of the year, you'll have memorized 52 verses. And it's God's Word. It's that shield of, it's that not only the shield of faith, but the sword of the Spirit that is able to cut down any temptation that will come your way. So I want to encourage you again to memorize God's Word. Meditate on God's Word, and it will help you in overcoming your temptations. God has provided a way out for us, and He wants you to have victory every single day, in every single circumstance, any temptation that comes your way. He's provided a way out. He's given us that valuable tool, the sword of the Spirit, God's Word. So hide it in your heart. Before you can say no to temptation, you got to say yes to Jesus Christ. And if you've never said yes to Jesus Christ, I would encourage you, do it tonight. Say, Jesus, I want to say yes to You. Yes to what You did on the cross for me. And yes, I believe that You rose from the dead to bring hope and life to us and to all who will believe. You do that, Jesus will come, and He'll provide strength for you. So once again, before you say no to the temptation, say yes. Jesus, I say yes to You. Come and help me and minister to me and cause me to be victorious. Amen. In Jesus' name, do it. Lord, we close our time this evening in saying thank You for Your Word. Thank You for the sword of the Spirit. Thank You, Lord, that You give us a way out of temptation, that You'll never allow us as Your people, as Your children, You'll never allow us to experience more temptation than what we can handle. But the Scripture, You said You'd provide a way out for us. And so we thank You for that, Lord. I pray for each and every one of my dear friends this evening, Lord. Oh, strengthen them. May they sense Your presence. Surround them with Your presence. Fill them with Your peace. Lord, when fears and anxieties, that temptation comes to succumb to that, Lord, I pray that You'd rebuke that. Rebuke fears and rebuke anxieties in Jesus' name, Lord. And then fill, Lord, as we give ourselves to Your Word, fill our souls, our mind, will, and emotions with Your promises that You're with us, that You never leave us, You never forsake us. And we're thankful for that, Lord Jesus. And now we pray that You be with each and every person. We also ask, Lord, that You be with our president and the Senate as they're on the brink of making a very critical, crucial decision in filling a Supreme Court justice vacancy. Lord, in Jesus' name, give them wisdom and direction, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Lord, who has slipped into eternity. We pray for her family. We pray for her family that, Lord, this evening, they would sense Your presence, speak to them and minister to them. Lord, during this difficult time, we pray. And we pray this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Well, God bless you, everyone. We look forward to connecting again, 10:30 a.m. For church online. And then Sunday evening at 6 o'clock, we'll be meeting in person and having a great time of fellowship and partaking of communion together. God bless you, everyone. Always great to be together. Hallelujah.